thank you for your public spirit and your public service, but I can't cut you any deals because you're in the penitentiary, and we get a click. I mean, they're done. And so there are opportunities for this information that can solve a lot of crimes. There is obviously a recommendation by the BCJC, which is a group that is equally composed of prosecutors and defense counsel. And we operate on a consensus, and this had a unanimous, not just a consensus, but a unanimous vote of both prosecutors and defense counsel that this is something that is needed. This is modeled to some degree on the Federal Rule of Criminal Procedure 35B, which has been in existence for a long period of time. The feds have been able to make use of this, and it's worked well for them over the years. Under the Federal Rule of Criminal Procedure 35, and under this proposed bill, the triggering mechanism is upon motion of the prosecutor. And under the federal case law that has interpreted this, the courts have come to the position that it is the prosecutor who knows whether or not the person has provided substantial assistance. This actually is sort of Rule 35 that is beefed up, however, because in the federal rule, there is no definition of what comprises of substantial assistance. And in this particular bill, there is a definitional section that is based on federal rules, well, not within 35B, but some other federal sentencing rules as to what substantial assistance is. But we've actually codified those definitions of what substantial assistance is. And so, again, this works well in the federal system, and we would ask the body to pass and report this bill out.
Mr. Chair, we're discussing up here, and there's something that I know happens because it happened in one of our cases we prosecuted a lifetime ago. But what it was, the guy gets 10 years, and at some point while he's working his way through the DOC system, he ends up in the same cell as somebody with a murder case. And I remember because it was done over our objection, he testified against the defendant, and then it was reduced from there was some sort of application to the court, because I remember we argued about it. How did that happen?
Couldn't. I mean, there's a case in Ray Department of Corrections for 222 Virginia, whatever the page number is, but there's plenty of case law that says that cannot happen. And in fact, in Ray Department of Corrections.
What was the year of that case?
84, 86.
So one of my facts, I remember them as wrong. So what
yeah, no, but basically, this is a case out of, as I recall, this is a case out of Buckingham County, somewhere in that area, where there are a number of individuals who had been in a drug conspiracy. They'd gone off to DOC. They then came back with the Commonwealth getting involved with it as well. The Commonwealth attorney agreed. The defense attorneys agreed. They modified the sentence downward. Department of Corrections appealed to the Supreme Court of Virginia. The Supreme Court of Virginia said that you have no jurisdiction to enter such an order. I mean, prosecution, absent this, even if the prosecutor agrees to this, without this bill, it just can't happen. I don't know how it happened in your jurisdiction.
Delegate Klein. So this has to have the concurrence of the Commonwealth or the motion of the Commonwealth.
It has to be upon motion. I mean, the motion of the Commonwealth is a trick. And again, the case on the federal system is the prosecutor knows best whether or not there's been substantial assistance that's been extended to the government, to the Commonwealth.
Other question, is there any minimum amount of a sentence that must be served in the federal system, or?
Actually, under the federal rule, it goes even further than what this does in that downward departure. Under the federal rule, it allows for a downward departure below the mandatory minimum. We did not include that in this. If you've got a mandatory minimum sentence, whatever it might be, the court does not have the authority under this particular bill to go below that mandatory minimum. So, again, the federal rule is much more extensive and can have a much lower downward departure than what this bill allows.
This, Mr. Chairman, this would allow a reduction to time served, essentially?
It could. Now, keeping in mind that this is not in the bill because it is a situation where it is, we believe that the courts need to have the discretion, and there may not be an agreement. My understanding in the federal system is that most of the time when these come up in the federal court, I'm not saying this is required, but most of the time when these come up, in the federal courts, there's a plea agreement between the government and the defendant as to what the downward departure is going to be. I understand that that is not in this bill, and we deliberately did not include that in this bill, because we might not have an agreement as to what the downward departure ought to be.
Mr. Chair?
I would just respond to Delegate Klein that that is the situation that already exists. The difference is that someone is in the custody of DOC versus in the jail. So, for example, if they had remained in the jail pending the outcome of the case in which they're offering testimony, they could be found, they could be sentenced to time served at that point. So this just means that if they're already in DOC custody.
I'm sorry. Okay.
Question. How is it that a jail can make that determination? Is this because
Mr. Chairman, if I might answer that, because I've seen it happen many a time with a sentencing order, basically orders the sheriff not to release him to the Department of Corrections. I've seen this done in drug conspiracy cases. I can think of one particular instance where a guy got 40 years to get the maximum on a drug distribution charge, and he won at a state level. He wound up cooperating with the federal authorities, but the feds did not have the authority to reduce his state sentence. So the state judge ordered that he remain in the local jail, and he wound up remaining in the local jail for about 3 years before the federal investigation was done. And at that point, we were able to go before the local circuit court judge, and the judge wound up giving him consideration as far as his cooperation. And he cooperated. We were able to clean up a major
drug. I bet he did.
He was. Yeah.
I bet he cooperated.
Oh, yes, he did. Absolutely.
Mr. Chair, just to clarify a little bit further, in my own experience as a prosecutor, I can tell you that we'll have a situation where somebody has been prosecuted and found guilty but not yet sentenced to distribution of narcotics, are willing to then testify against another one of their drug distributors. And so as a result, we put in a hold letter, a physical request to the local jail to keep them in custody, preserving the court's jurisdiction over the sentencing of that individual, and then revisits their sentencing on a later date. If this allows that to just happen if they're in the custody of DOC versus the local jail.
Mr. Chair?
Delegate Bill.
I think I get it, but I might ask this. Mr. Doucette. So, flip this all around. You have a new Commonwealth come in, and his electoral, he says, I'm going to cut everybody's sentences in half. I just think that this has been a rotten county for a long time. What about this? I understand usually the Commonwealth is going to be the safeguard against that happening. So everything has to go through a judge.
Everything has to go through a judge, absolutely. We would not have the authority to cut a sentence unilaterally.
Anyone in opposition to the bill want to speak? Okay.
Move to report.
Move to report. Is there a second?
Second.
Report as amended. Adopt as the amendment.
Mr. Chair.
Shelley Watts.
Of the chair, is the maneuver here that if we were so to do so, we would move to report as amended Delegate Collins's bill, and then I would then move to strike my bill? Is that
and be the chief co-patron
of his?
Mm-hmm. I think that would be correct.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
And that's because they're identical.
Right.
We're not supposed to incorporate identical bills into one another.
It doesn't really matter the procedure. I just want to make sure that I get.
shows that it was incorporated in the language of looking him up, that's the most desirable, as opposed to just being stricken.
Okay, I'm just telling you what the directive that I heard was identical bills should not be rolled into one another, so.
Yeah, and I was aware, that one I was got under my arms, I was just actually weren't originally the guys.
So to make it so that I could be incorporated into his bill and his name is the chief, would we move at this point to, I guess, remove his prior amendments? And then, because we would not be in compliance, my bill would be incorporated into his, and he would end up.
Let's just incorporate yours into his and see what the heck happens. I'll be very clear, that is not the rule anymore, like that. I know we do that, used to do that relatively freely, but I don't think that's gonna happen so much anymore. Anyway, so that's the motion to incorporate his bill into yours. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye, those opposed, that is done. The motion is to report House Bill 188 as amended. Please cast your vote. Alright, close the roll. That bill is recommended to report. Elliot Collins, do you have another?
I do not. It was passed by for the day.
Okay. Delegate Herring, do you have a bill?
Yes. First of all, line amendment.
What is the bill?
Oh, I'm sorry. House Bill 1055.
Alright, please turn your attention to House Bill 1055. Delegate Herring.
If it's a clerk, can we end the line amendment?
Mr. Chairman, on line 22, after the word departure, strike all the new language. The written explanation shall adequately explain the sentence opposed to promote fair sentencing.
Strike that whole sentence. Okay.
All right.
So what does that leave us with?
It leaves us with language on line 43 through 45. And this bill has been introduced before, and I'll explain why I keep bringing it back. This bill deals with the written explanation that judges are supposed to give about why they depart from the recommended guidelines, either up or down. It's been a continuing problem in Virginia that some judges are not writing the written explanation. I'm just going to give some examples from my big handout. In some circuits, we have judges at 9.9% of the time not doing it. A judge in the 18th Circuit, 11.8%. So this is not just one judge issue, it's judges all across the Commonwealth. Another judge, 27th Circuit, 7.1% of the time. And these are just examples. So there are judges who actually do what they're supposed to do, and they do it each time. So I will freely admit, and the panel needs to know that, yes, our percentage is a little a bit above 2.4%, or I think it's around there right now. But my concern is that I think that someone who's convicted and sentenced needs to know the reason why a judge departed from the recommended guidelines. And this relief is not an appeal, it's just requiring that the judge provide an explanation. I just imagine that some inmates probably know why and some don't know why. And I think that it's just a fair
Mr. Chair,
Bill.
Okay, so the new era of bipartisanship here. Let's talk about this. So
let's see how far this goes.
No. could OES come up, please? So the chairman of the subcommittee. I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, I have the floor. Ma'am, so the chairman said, why don't you make an even stronger worded letter to the sentencing commission? I said, but that's just the sentence. All they do is keep track, and Meredith gets strongly worded letters from me once every other week and ignores them. So the question would be, she's right. We have almost every judge doing great. I see 0.8, 0.0, 1.8, 0.0. We get little like oversights that probably all you need is to say, hey, dum-dum, you forgot.
And then a small number, and I'm sure Delegate Herring has looked through this more carefully than I have, that are way off. All of a sudden you get 8%. You know, a bunch of 1% and 8%. I see an 18%. There's a separation of powers issue here. We can't actually tell the judges what to do except once every 8 years. But, you know, you don't want to have too many absolutes, but I would suggest that this is, we're getting real close to one here. And I don't want to speak for this Delegate Herring's issue, but the judges are being told to do something. She's right. It's fair that if you're going to go up or down, really, frankly, you ought to at least give them some reason. I guess I'm now asking for a suggestion. What can we do? We said she's bringing these bills year after year, and we kind of made it clear to the judges we thought that this really matters to us, and you've got a handful of outliers.
Eileen Longenecker with OES at the Supreme Court. I guess in response to your question, I would partly tell you what we have done. And when this bill came back, I think this is the third year for the bill. Last year in April, a letter was sent out to all sitting and retired circuit court judges discussing just this issue and reminding them about this. At the May mandatory circuit court judges conference, it was mentioned as part of the legislative presentation to remind them about this issue and remind them about this bill, even though it did not pass. And usually we only talk about bills that pass because the judges need to know the changes in the law. This was one of a couple of bills that was mentioned. We address it at pre-bench and will continue to do all of those things. So I'm not sure I have an answer to your question as to what else can be done. Clearly, the law is clear. And I think we will continue to address the issue as we have been addressing it. 2 years ago, Delegate Albo was part of a panel at the Circuit Court Judges Conference, and he mentioned it and told all the Circuit Court judges it would be included in the Sentencing Commission's report on each judge who was up for re-election. So I don't know if that is responsive to your question, but we have tried to address it.
So we all do this. So we're in circuit court, the judge departs up or down. When could somebody say, there's two kinds of things going on. One is judge's oversight, one would be the judge just is looking us in the eye and telling us he won't do it. The former, though, is there any steps where someone could send it back to the judge and say, hey, I'm sure it was an oversight, but I see that in this case you missed one. And all these ones that are 0.7%, I'm sure would probably like to be zero. Those are clearly really trying, just leaving one off. But I'm wondering, would that get us at least down to the 4 or 5 apples in this bucket that are just refusing to do it, notwithstanding all of your reminders?
The only comment I would make is that every judge handles things differently, every court is differently. Some have clerks sitting in the court, some don't. And so I'm not sure there is one method for trying to improve this.
Count 5 of them that are more than 10% of the time not doing what they're reported to do, and I'd say a couple of 18%.
Mr. Chair, or Mr. Hooper, Chair, I would like to note that in terms of these judges doing what the General Assembly would expect of them in this regard, that I note that our former colleagues, Judge Shannon and Judge Athey, have 0.0% deviations. Good for them. Anyway, yes. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Can I just speak to the patron?
Yes.
So, just thinking of ideas here.
Yeah.
We have been told, maybe we could stay and just make this a conversation, that the judges very quickly, through the judge grapevine, hear when we bring up issues at the reappointment phase. And so, for instance, I was upset about restitution this year. And just asked every judge that came up. I said, so there's $230 million that you guys aren't collecting. What are you doing about it? The 4 or 5 that were there was not such a big deal, but I very quickly heard from other judges and through the Virginia Law Weekly that once they know that that's coming up in the reappointment phase, oh my goodness, that's something that they then realize is important to us. Yep, and we had the previous, about 10 years ago, big fight about deferred dismiss, and the same thing. We asked each one that came up, and we said, what are your procedures? And boy, it was very clear from judicial conferences that they were hearing this very clearly. It might be time. I mean, we could it's too late to do it this year, but I mean, the next time that comes on, not ask them for the data, but you, I mean, just form a group of us, and if I, after about the fourth time, the fourth judge comes in and he says, so I see it, yeah. Or even, I'm just trying to think of other things we could do.
Delegate Bell, Mr. Chairman, you know, I certainly don't think it would be a problem for us to include the bill, the prior bill, was it Delegate Lindsay's?
1312.
Where the chair is asking the Sentencing Commission to provide a detailed list for each judge. I don't see any issue with us mentioning that at the Circuit Court Judges Conference.
And I'm a believer that, you know, saying that's what is measured gets done. If this information were in front of us, just like the sentencing guidelines, we had some very interesting discussions about a couple of the outlying judges on the sentencing. It's like Delegate Watts, that's something that's right in front of me. The judge comes up and I say, that's interesting, Judge Arrington. Please explain why in your whole circuit you are missing this thing more often than all the other judges combined. You have five judges in the circuit, combined they miss less than you. Really troubled why, just because the Delegate Gilbert said.
Sometimes
there was a well, no, sure, the one actually helped. The one Delegate Gilbert said we asked him to do this. That's not actually accurate. We ordered him to do it. This is part of the law, right? It's a shall. So I don't, with all that, Mr. Chair, I don't have strong feelings about the specific way to get there. But I think we're telling them to do it, they're not doing it. And ultimately, they can be taken off the bench. The ultimate sanction would be one person goes off the bench over this, and they will never miss another one in the history of time.
So, and Mr. Chair, I mean, I guess really my concern is that individual that's sentenced, and, you know, our whole goal of, you know, people serving their time and understanding why, and I think the time that's going to go by to educate them, these judges, is there are people who don't know, and that's my concern, is that people at least have a venue or avenue to request that higher court say, you know, judge, you missed this one. You need to provide an explanation, and it's not, you know, it's that, and that's my concern, is I think people need to know how serious their crime was in the judge's view, that they accelerated their sentence, or, you know, I think that they have a right to know, and I think that was the intent of the legislature, and so I'm just providing somebody some relief.
Delegate Collins.
I'm sorry.
Delegate Watts.
I'm going to say this because please correct me if I have the wrong impression. But looking at deviations several years ago, there was the biggest deviations were in sex crimes, because very often you were darn sure that something else happened, but all you could prove was, and so you pled down, or vice versa, and that's what you could prove. And so, does the sentence, am I accurate, and does the Sentence Commission take into account the content of those explanations in any of its discussion of types of crimes as to what the breadth of sentencing recommendations might be, even though we have an average?
Mr. Chairman, Meredith Furrer, Owens from the Sentencing Commission. The guidelines are prepared based on the offenses at conviction. So whatever the final conviction offense is, that's how the guidelines will be prepared. But certainly other information, details about the offense, the circumstances of the offense, will be presented to the judge, and the judge can take those into consideration. And very likely the judge does know what the real offense behavior was in that case, and will take those things into consideration when determining a sentence for that individual.
One follow-up question. Is it appropriate to specifically refer to plea bargaining?
Absolutely. In fact, we have told the judges, we have check boxes on our sentencing guidelines cover sheet. If the judge checks one of the boxes that they accepted a plea agreement in the case, we accept that as a departure reason. The judge wouldn't have to write anything else on the form if the box is checked that says plea agreement, accepted a plea agreement. So in that case, you know, what the figures you have in front of you, take that into account. So if they had checked the box for plea agreement, we consider that a departure reason and would not be scored as a missing departure reason on this report.
Mr. Chair.
Delegate Bowman.
I would just say in my own circumstance prosecuting juvenile sex crimes, there are a number of instances where because the victim is not capable or ready to testify, that we end up pleading the case.
case to a lower subsection of crimes. But then the testimony at trial, at sentencing, takes into account the full panoply of what actually occurred to the kid. And so I actually am looking at this list and shocked that a couple of my judges have very high numbers on this, which is a concerning outcome. But I would echo what Delia Watt says, which is this happens, in my experience, most often in sex cases.
So,
counsel, do you?
Mr. Chairman, the only thing I'll say is I think that, you know, the relief prescribed here is actually relief that's already available to anybody. Filing is a ministerial duty, so they could file a mandamus under 644, I'm sorry, at this point without this statute.
He was saying you could do it already without it. You can file a written mandamus. Billy Collins.
I want to run through the process real quick. I don't know if the Supreme Court can answer this or anybody in our field from judicial. So if, as a defense attorney, my client is sentenced and the judge says, I know that your top of your guidelines is 5 years, but I'm giving you 20 years, have a nice life, and walks off the bench. I then say, judge, you know, please, by statute, you have to give me an explanation, and the judge comes back and he says, because I can't, and walks off the bench again. What's my recourse at that particular point as counsel? Is that a jerk complaint? I know this clause says adequately, and saying I can because I'm a judge is an adequate response, I think, in some argument. And I recognize that that's kind of an extreme example, but.
I mean, I guess the defense attorney could file a jerk complaint. I mean, I don't mean to be so simple about it, but I mean, if the defense attorney feels that's appropriate, if given the judge's response, then that's an avenue always available.
Well, what I'm looking at here is we have a couple. It seems to be that we're doing a pretty good job, but we have a couple judges that have an 18% failure rate when it comes to adequately or to even giving an explanation. I'm just wondering if that is something that then comes back up for judicial performance review, and I'm wondering if that is something that should trigger us to maybe take the eye of Mordor. Look at a judge and maybe remove them from the otherwise cycle that they would be on and bring them in.
Mr. Chair? Billy Mullen. I have a question for possibly staff and maybe the Indigent Defense Commission as well. Under this statute, someone has a public defender or an appointed attorney. Wouldn't this allow the public defender or appointed attorney be able to file this as opposed to a mandamus, which would be outside of the breadth of a public defender's appointment? Am I correct in that? I guess my question is...
I don't think it'd be beyond the appointment. That doesn't give me any...
Would you be, as a public defender appointed to be able to defend your client in a criminal mm-hmm. case, would you be
yes.
capable of filing a mandamus
yes.
on the judge at this point? Yes.
I think so. That doesn't give me...
Without this question. That was, yes.
We don't have a position on this bill. It's a rather hollow remedy if you have the circumstances as Delegate Collins articulated, which is I'm going to give you 20 years on a guideline range of 1 to 5. But yeah, I would feel comfortable filing that motion.
Mr.
All right, I think the issue is, are we going to fire this volley across the bow of the judges or we're not? Let's go fast.
Can I ask you something real quick?
Delegate Bell.
You just happened to the person that's talking. ultimately, so we have to, again, the separation of powers issues, they come before us once you're great years in terms of literally telling them whether or not to keep up. That's the stage where somebody did what Collins said over and over. It would be clear it wasn't just an incidental and real busy. It would be positively, affirmatively refusing to do what the job is, right?
I have to do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's when you fire someone. You just, you say it's clear you're not.
And I hear you all. I just want to add to this. I mean, this is
I'm
not Charnel.
No, I'm not agreeing with you.
Yeah, I'm not. This is not Charnel just trying to want to do something. People came to me with this, and
rescinded, and there's no explanation. And I understand, I agree that we need, when the judges come in, we need to talk to them, ask them, you know, what's going on. But same time, there's somebody out there not knowing. And, you know, even, I know it may be hollow, but something, because I've seen sheets, sentencing sheets, it's blank.
Well, you can have a motion to resentence.
I know, so, but someone who doesn't have an attorney or can't contact their public defender, I mean, they are left without. And I just want to send a message not only to judges, but people. It was, sort of like, we really mean it. I hate to do that, really, we really mean it type of bill, but I think it's time that this has got to stop.
Did we strike the language on lines 23 and 24 yet? Did we
I think we did 22 to 23.
Okay. All right. Anybody in the audience wishing to speak either further in favor of or in opposition to the bill, please come forward. Okay. All right. The delegate Herring wanted to strike the italicized language on lines 22 and 23.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
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 Those opposed, that amendment is adopted, leaving only the which to that.
So we always have this issue about when we do something in one place and not someplace else. Is there any issue here about, if you say we can already do it, I'm not as adverse to sending a shot across the bow as some people perhaps, but I don't also don't mess up other things. Well, you go to the next, somebody wants to do mandamus on something else, and they go, General Assembly said mandamus here, we didn't say it someplace else. Is there any issue about?
Mr. Chairman, to the extent that may be a concern, the easiest way to fix it is just to put in a reference for when they are allowed to petition for a writ of mandamus to cross-reference in the article where mandamus is set forth in 801.
I'll move the amendment.
Second.
Anybody need any further explanation of the amendment? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, it's adopted. There's already a motion to report. All right. We'll just make that as amended. There's another second. Any further discussion?
Mr. Chairman,
Delegate Collins.
I just want to add one last thing. As a criminal practicing criminal defense attorney who does court appointed work, I was not aware until this moment that I was able to file a mandamus. So codifying what we can already do in the code so that it goes into the training manual, Virginia Indigent Defense Commission, I think would be helpful. Thank you.
Just reminded me I need to do the training again. I was against at the time.
It's wonderful now. You're
just saying, I'm all right.
It's fine.
Please cast your vote. All right. The bill is recommended for report.
Thank you.
I feel like we should note this moment. Right?
Right.
You don't want to hug it out?
Yeah.
Let's not. All right. Who wants to go next? Who's got a quick one? Anybody? I have House Bill 1015, which resolves a longstanding growing pet peeve of mine, which is that in the code 192.215.1, functions of a multi-jurisdiction grand jury, added crime after crime after crime to the list of things that a multi-jurisdiction grand jury can investigate. I remember doing a multi-jurisdiction grand jury at one point. One of the odd things about a multi-jurisdictional grand jury is you can investigate something that comes up in the course of an investigation that is done pursuant to any of these 30 things. So we had a robbery, an unsolved robbery. I think we used the fact that they went out and bought drugs after the robbery with the money they stole in the robbery and said, oh, this is a drug investigation. And then we figured out the drug part, and then we're like, okay, well, where'd they get the money? And now there's a robbery, and so then we solved the robbery using the multi-jurisdiction grand jury. And anyway, we just add one thing after another. So why not just say that you can investigate any felony crime in a multi-jurisdiction grand jury and call it a day? And so that's what the bill does. Delegate Bell.
I move to report the chairman's fit of tea.
Okay, I want to hear. I feel like I want to hear my former boss say what a great bill it is.
It's a magnificent
bill. Okay, thank you.
Sorry.
Well, what do we do? Any crime. That's what I want. I'm sorry.
Sure.
So, counsel, do you have any observations? Does anybody want to speak to the bill or think that we're going too far? Anybody in opposition? Delegate Winter.
No.
I mean,
too much power. I don't open these things.
It's wide open.
So it's any felony, any misdemeanor.
It's any crime. Any crime.
Martial law.
So just, I mean, can you, Cotter, can you rattle off all of, I mean, any of these things that, what these code sections are? I mean, it's all kinds of stuff, right?
Oh, yeah, no.
Rattle off some things.
Rattle.
A tree.
Article 9, 3.265, somebody at seek is animal cruelty. 18.2-30 at seek is crimes against the person murder. We've got gang crimes, we have drug crimes,
computer crimes,
human trafficking crimes,
gambling probably. Mm-hmm.
Gambling is a crime.
Okay, arson, everybody gets the point. There's a motion to report in a second. I'm not trying to make this go faster than it should, because it's a, over the years it's become less of a big change. Delegate Adams.
I have a question as part of the discussion, and maybe I'd like to hear a little bit about the legislative history on this. I mean, why do we start with enumerated crimes to start with? You know, did it become a Christmas tree effect over the years? And now your proposal is to open it wide open. I'm thinking maybe, you know, there must be some safeguards that someone must have, or some concerns that.
I don't know where it started, but an anecdote, the year or two before I was in the legislature, we had an issue in Shenandoah County where I was an assistant commonwealth attorney, and I was looking through the multi-jurisdictional grand jury section, and lo and behold, there was nothing in there that allowed you to investigate gang crimes. So I called up Senator Openshain, my senator, and I said, hey, it's not in there, it should be in there. And he called up the then Attorney General, and became part of their legislative package. And I imagine things just like that have happened all these different times where somebody called and said, boy, we'd like to have this authority. And they went to the legislature and got it. And that's how this Christmas tree got built. But I don't, maybe
I,
Mr. Cotter can. Sure.
Unless there was something in recodification that I'm missing, and I knew a lot less in those days, noticed the first, not year here is 1983. Philpott was speaker. I very vaguely remember him being very, very upset about the whole concept of multi-jurisdictional grand juries. I do not know, I cannot accurately state what his constitutional objection was, but it was on a constitutional Bill of Rights issue that he was particularly concerned about the whole concept of multi-jurisdictional grand juries. Nevertheless, the body eventually passed the bill, and you'll notice that the next amendment wasn't until 1991, and Philpott, I believe, at that time was no longer speaker. So there was some very basic history, and so once you, to justify it, you had to be very specific about what type of crimes we're calling for, and once the Christmas tree started, then there was no turning back to what the chair's bill is all about.
Okay, why don't you say that for everybody?
Mr. Chairman, we pulled up the version from 1991 of this 19.2-2-15.1, and at the time, it involved drug crimes, perjury, and obstruction.
You really had to justify it hard to get a passable
obstruction. Yes.
Okay, the motion is to report. Any further discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Delegate Adams.
Could council answer this? Maybe just give, for the benefit of the body here, a brief description of the additional powers that a multi-jurisdictional grand jury is going to have, or is it just simply with regard to?
Mr. Chairman, Delegate Adams, they have, I think, a much wider subpoena power. They can investigate through the use of subpoenas. They're secretive. So you have to be sworn into multi-jurisdictional grand jury and what's going on there. And so obviously if you're a defense attorney, you have no access to what's going on. So they, like a special grand jury that would be impaneled as opposed to the regular grand jury, they are much more investigative than they are just ham sandwich issuing indictments. They also meet much more frequently than the regular grand jury does. They're not bound by the term of the court, and so that indictments can be put out.
Mr. Chairman, I have a follow-up question, if I may, and maybe this will be for, have there been any particular examples of, or a particular need lately that has shown itself in recent years that where a multi-jurisdictional grand jury would have been useful, but was not available, or anything like that that might be promised?
I think my intention behind this bill is that I believe we've reached a tipping point where there are more things in here than not, and why don't I just go ahead and finish this off rather than having to do this piecemeal for the next 10 years. So get every other crime in here, which I think is where we're at.
Mr. Chairman, just ever so briefly, the bill that I brought forward, because jurisdictional lines are not something that the criminal is aware of at all, so the activity, particularly in urban areas, like the predatory behavior, easily goes back and forth over jurisdictional lines, so that if you're going to effectively deal with it, it has to be on a multi-jurisdictional basis.
I think if I had been prepared to rattle off all the crimes, as we haphazardly tried to do, it would sound a lot more ridiculous where we find ourselves, and I could be prepared to do that. I'm happy to, if you have concerns, I'm happy to put the brakes on.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I guess on the one hand, I suppose it speaks to the integrity of the system that we have and the commonwealths that we have in place that we don't have people lined up opposing or objecting. But it does seem like a very broad brush stroke, and
it's already very broad, it would be my argument in response, but it's well taken.
That's my only reservation, I suppose.
Well, I'd be delighted to let everybody think about and talk out the reservations further on another day. I'm happy to do that if you time to ponder this. Rather than have you,
we're welcome.
Happy that, okay, I'd ask this to go by today, so it will. And what quick ones do we have?
Mr. Chair, I'm going to sort of caucus it. It seems there's two that we could do in 5 minutes and get them off our board. Delegate Mullen has one, and I have one.
Go
first.
Delegate Mullen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have HB 1260, which is expanding the rebuttal presumption against bail to four additional crimes that are the key overlapping crimes that involve human trafficking. The Hampton Roads Human Trafficking Task Force came at the brought this bill as a request. It expands those crimes to essentially kidnapping someone for the purpose of prostitution, receiving money from prostitution, receiving money from the earnings of the prostitute, or commercial sex trafficking. Those are four statutes that now would incorporate a presumption against bond. The circumstances circumstances where a human trafficker and their victim are arrested in a similar situation. The trafficker makes bond and then goes and bails out the person that they've been abusing. And they both all make a run for it. That's something that we've seen a lot, certainly in Hampton Roads area. I can't speak to the rest of the state, but this remains a rebuttable presumption, but the hope is that we'll be able to break the level of contact between someone who has been kidnapped and remains in essentially sex slavery from their abuser for a period long enough that we can actually break that cycle of abuse.
Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of the bill?
Mr. Chair, Mike Jagels. I've worked for the Attorney General's Office in the Major Crime Section. Since November of 2016, we've been participating with state and federal law enforcement, as well as victim services advocates, in a Hampton Roads Regional Task Force, Human Trafficking Regional Task Force. And we've come across situations where, as Delegate Mullen has suggested, where pimps and human traffickers not only are not showing up for court after they get bonded out, but like as Delegate Mullen indicated, they're bonding out, they're getting out themselves and then bonding out the very people who are victims of the sex trafficking. These are, as Delegate Mullen has stated, four serious crimes that we seek to be added to the list of rebuttable presumption against bail. Prostitution is not one of those, so victims of prostitution would still be able to get out on bond and get services they need.
Why is it limited to if the alleged victim is a family or household member again?
That is one of the enumerated felonies where it, and that's just for that last section.
That last one, I apologize.
Correct.
Okay.
And so there are four felonies: taking or detaining a person for the purpose of prostitution or unlawful sexual intercourse. The second is receiving money or for procuring or placing a person in a house of prostitution or forced labor. The third is receiving money from the earnings of a prostitute. And finally, as Delegate Gilbert said, commercial sex trafficking where the alleged victim is a family or household member. So on behalf of the Attorney General, we support this bill.
Second motion to
The words family or household member don't appear in 357.1. Why are you limiting it to that?
I'm pulling up 357.1 as we speak.
That's not
I move to strike family or household number. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Sure.
To amend to remove section involving family or household.
All right, so we'd have to clean it up a little better than that. Well, how would it would read?
You just need to stick it or between 357 and 357.1 and strike the remainder of line 56 and 57.
Okay. Everybody understand that amendment?
Yeah.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? All right, that amendment is adopted. Sure. Somebody's got to pay attention. It's usually not me.
That's it. Pulled it out, though.
Yeah.
Right. He would wake up and save the day.
That's right.
All right. Is there a motion?
Make the report.
There's a motion to report. And a second as amended. Any further discussion? Please cast your vote. Delegate Bell, that bill is recommended to the polls.
Mr. Chair, I want to bring up House Bill 514. And I think some smart person is going to explain why it's not necessary. But I couldn't figure out why it's not necessary. The sheriff in my home jurisdiction said that we may have an unattended death. They just want to go in and make sure that it's not a murder or a suicide, and they can't get search warrant because they don't have any information.
his idea. He's not able, or he's not coming today, so this is more of an intellectual issue at this point. But hopefully someone will tell us there's a reason why we don't need to do that, and we can table it. If that's not true, then I don't want to really work on it today. I want to gear it over to the next day.
Council.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Doucette and I had conversations about this earlier. So my thought on this is that since we did not pass a bill that decriminalized suicide, do you still have the power that is a crime, so you can issue a probable cause warrant for that? The issue with this as written is you are basically saying that you want the magistrate to issue a search warrant for a crime, for something you do not have any evidence of at this point. And so that if you were to issue this search warrant and enter this home based on this search warrant and then find that it is in fact a homicide and that the wife did it or the husband did it, then you would have an issue going to trial on that, because even though a statute authorizes a search warrant or the magistrate can issue a search warrant, it is still going to be judged as to whether or not there was probable cause for it. And you are saying in this that we do not have any evidence of a crime at this point, but we want to go in and look anyway. And so if you issued a search warrant based on you're looking for evidence of the crime of suicide, which we did not repeal, then you do not need this code section to be, or this section to be in this code section. If you're going to say, if you can argue that a dead body alone, with unexplained dead body alone, gives you probable cause to go in and look how that body died, then you don't need this as well, because you have probable cause to issue a warrant.
Mr. Chair, I see some good people in the room that if this were happening everywhere and they're having trouble with this, I think would come forward. But might I ask if the state police or the sheriff's association or backup sees this as a problem that needs addressing? Under my own rule, if it's not a problem, we don't go wandering through the code, just correcting stuff.
Mr. Chairman, Mike Doucette, executive director of Virginia Association of Columbus Attorneys. I've not had it as a Columbus attorney in the city of Lynchburg, but I've heard anecdotally over and over again where magistrates are refusing to issue search warrants concerning potential suicides. And obviously we're working in a situation where we're trying to determine whether it was a suicide, whether it was a homicide, what it was. If it's something that might appear to be a suicide at first, might very well turn out to be a homicide or vice versa. And we're just not able to get in. And again, I've not had it personally, so I can't give you a particular fact pattern. But I've heard, you know, over and over again from other prosecutors where this has been a problem.
Mr. Chair, we've been PDIing bills because we want to make sure they're done. Might I ask this one table? And I say that in case the gentleman who was supposed to come today and testify about it decided that it really is a big deal, and wants to come down, or someone else hearing these thoughts says, oh my gosh, that's a huge problem, why don't you carry this forward? But otherwise, I just didn't have a table today.
On the table. Is there a second?
Second.
All right, that is a recorded vote.